Okay, so now we're going to talk real briefly about strain rate. We won't do a lot of rate dependent stuff in this class, but when we do talk about plasticity, we do things in rate form a lot of times. So I'll go ahead and show you what the strain rate is. And again, we'll derive it for the full sort of nonlinear version and then linearize it. And that's sort of my preferred way to do it, even though there's a very straightforward way to just arrive at the linearized strain. Okay, so now we're going to talk about strain rate. Right. So if we have our little infinitesimal small vector dx, and we want to see how it changes with time, right? So we take the derivative of it, then we can change the order of, we can basically pull the d outside and then have dx dt, right? Well, dx dt, we typically, use a symbol v for that. So that's just the velocity. This is the velocity vector, right? So this guy is dv, right? And, remember v, this is a little v, right? So it's in the current configuration, right? So this is a function of little x1 little x2, little x3 in time, right? And so if we look at how this spatially changes, what's dv, well then we arrive at, I won't derive it explicitly like we did before, but you have the same sort of relationship, right? So you have this gradient term dx, okay? And this thing, dvd or partial vi partial xj, remember anytime you have two free indices in a term, right, these indices go from 1 to 3, so it's a tensor or a matrix in this case, right? Second order tensor, so 3 by 3 matrix, right? So that thing, we're going to define it as L. L is the velocity gradient. One thing you'll notice about me is I'm a really bad speller. Okay, velocity gradient. Okay, and so we might write this as L dx, right? But you might have wanted to write this change in the velocity vector in terms of the current, the reference configuration, right? So from our definition that d little x is f dx, right, we can just plug that guy right in and we can write that L f dx. Okay. So just for a second, let's compute the time derivative of the deformation gradient, so df dt, right? So we might write this as d dt partial xi partial xj. Right, and then, we can swap the order of differentiation. So, say d xi dt partial xj. Right. And again, this is v. So Let's see. So now, if the deformation gradient is invertible, right? So if xi, xj, right? Then if it's invertible, then you can just invert that relationship, right? And turns out the deformation gradient being invertible is a condition on the deformation. It has to be. If it's not invertible, that means the material is like folding in on itself. So it's a physically incompatible deformation mode. So the deformation gradient has to be invertible for a valid deformation to be occurring. So if we just multiply this guy on both sides of this equation, so we have dxk, dxj, partial fk, xj. Right. Now, remember, this is like dv with respect to big xj, right? So what we're trying to do here, so this is, to be clear, this term is not the velocity gradient. This is, when you write it out, this is dv partial big xj, right? So what we want to do is we want to write it in terms of little xj. So basically that's why we multiply it on the right side with this F inverse, and we can cancel those guys, and what comes out then is dvi d little xj, which is L, right? And now over here we have F inverse F dot. So basically, we just derived a relationship for how you can actually come up with L, F inverse F dot. Right. So deformation gradient is, you know, it's so fundamental, we can just write, take its derivative and then use F inverse to get the velocity gradient, which is completely in the current configuration. Okay, so again, we're after strain rate. So remember when we sort of defined strain, we talked about the difference in these line segments, right? Right, so we had this difference of line segments, and then we made some substitutions, and that's how we derived the green strain. Well, if we just took the time derivative of this expression, then we have ddt d little s squared and minus ddt big s d big s squared. But d big s is in the reference configuration, right? That's the original length of the line, so it doesn't change with time. So its partial derivative derivative with respect to time is zero, right? So this first term is what we need to evaluate the derivative of. So again, d dt ds is equal to d dt d little x transpose dx ds squared, right? So if you just go back and look at the notes from last time, we showed where that comes from. So ds squared is dx transpose dx, right? sort of the Euclidean norm. Okay. And so then we'll use a chain rule on this guy. So we have dx dt dx plus dx transpose d dx dt. So we have dv transpose, right? This is v. This is v. This is v. So dv, we have dv transpose dx plus dx transpose dv. And then we showed that dv is equal to L dx, right? So plugging in dv is equal to L dx. We derived that on the last page. So we'll plug that in, right? So we have L dx transpose dx plus dx transpose L dx. And so then when you take the transpose of two vectors, two tensors multiplying one another, it's the transpose of each of them in reverse, right? So we have dx transpose L transpose dx plus dx transpose L dx, right? And so now we'll factor out our dx's. So we have LT plus L dx. Okay, now we're going to introduce another definition, and I'm going to show you there's going to be, well, let's just do it, right? So this is 2 times d, where d is the rate of deformation. So d is 1/2 L transpose plus L, right? So this is the rate of deformation tensor. Okay, now where does 1/2 come from? Well, if I went back up here and I just would have, I don't know what ds is, but if I would have, if I would have differentiated it, you know, say d dt ds squared, if I would have differentiated it directly, then I would have got 2 ds d dt ds, right? So it's this 2 here, that's where it comes from. So this is the rate of deformation tensor, and you know, what can we say about it? Well, one thing is it's symmetric, so if I take the transpose of it, I get L transpose transpose plus L transpose is equal to 1/2 L transpose L is equal to D, right? So it's symmetric. And if we write it in component form, right, then we have 1/2 VI partial XJ plus VJ partial XI. Okay. And if we use that same argument that we made in that, you know, for small strains, for small displacements rather, where we have x is x plus u, right? For small displacements, x is approximately big X, right? And so in that case, you know, this would be the strain rate. So, you know, it's clear this is a rate, right? V is d dt d of x, right? So this is a rate, the strain rate, d dv xi. Right, so in the small, you know, in the small displacement limit, there's no, you know, I've said it many times, I'll say it again. in the small displacement limit, there's no difference between x, you know, little x and big X. Right? So that's all I have for today. It's going to let you guys out a little early. Part of that was by design because I have to catch a flight. And also because I've already recorded the next lecture. Normally, I would just keep going in my notes, right, until the end of class. But since I've already recorded at the next lecture, I had to have a stopping point that I know I could get to so that I could start, you know, the next one. So with that, unless there's any questions, you're free to go.